So now we are to the next step, which is today we try to write a very small program solving a linear equation, a trivial problem for the mathematics, but this is useful to explain some features of the Java language. So the usual motto, not the usual actually. What do we ask for a program when we write a program? Program must be short. The shorter, the better, because a program you can control the errors in the short program, and you can control the error in the large program. So there is a consequence. In fact, Java is made like this. You do short programs because the classes are short programs. But you have to test each program any time you do it. And then you do a short program, you test it, you do several, a crash test on the program, and then you forget for the program for the future. You don't touch it anymore and you reuse it. That's the philosophy. Readable means that you have to read the program like you read a book, like you read the comics, very, very easily. If the program is not very readable, it's not very usual. In 6 months, you are not reminding what the program is about, if the program is too complex. Robust means, usually robust is the things that scientific programmers, let's say, level, PhD level, don't know what it is.
Usually.
Meaning, you run, the program has to run any time. It doesn't have to crash for particular reasons. And so you have to, it has to be prone error, you have to be able to treat the errors. That also is a problem of testing, and testing and testing again. The program must be obviously correct, meaning that it works. It works fine, but correct from two point of view. One point of view is the informatics, the other point of view for us is the physics. Two things do not coincide, obviously. Manageable, short, I said short, but should be also, is made short, and all the things made to be managed, to be reused, to be useful other way, and to be eventually improved or a factor, as we say in computer science, and not in computer science anyway. And so the program that doesn't have these characteristics at the end is not transmittable. So if you want to do open science, we have to do programs that have all these characteristics. Documented, then we will see also how to document programs. The better documenting is to write clear code. So we want to write a program that exploits some features of object-oriented programming, very simple features. We introduce also tools for I/O, but not today, tomorrow. Today we just separate our problem. We analyze the problem, we analyze the part in which we can decompose the problem. Each part will be then a class. And then we will put together the class maybe in 2 days. So the problem is expressed in mathematical form in this way. We have two real numbers, A and B, any two real number, a linear equation in AX plus B equal to zero, an equation that we know since the elementary school. Not really, let's say the middle school. And the solution is known to exist in B equal to x equals to minus B over A. So if you rush to solve this problem, which is very easy to solve in any language, and you probably don't need a program to solve this, but this is, you just plug this formula into your favorite language. But then, for instance, you don't take into account that A must be different from Z. Yes, you have to, a lot of cases that you have to possibly analyze in advance. That's not even the case. In civil engineering, in fact, when you design something, you do a project and you have three or four steps of a project. First, you say if the project is feasible, then you try to figure out what the project is, of a house, of a system, and then you do a project where you specify every detail of the project. Even the screws, the everything, every single piece of window, that's not much different in programming. When we do a program, we should design first the program. And obviously we have to iterate the design, because we cannot think at the first sight to be able to do a program. It happens to me, I think, once in my life to do a program, to write the program right away, having the program that works. But that's because of what was a problem, a complex problem actually, but that I had already analyzed before for quite a long time. And I also had written chunks of code of it. So that was not actually the iteration was hidden in my history. So that's is what we have to do. So we started from a very simple problem, and so actually for designing, actually you have also to test. You can test writing on the paper before using the computer, or I prefer often to use the computer, so I do a small chunks of the program first with the idea to test what is going on. And then I complicate the thing, I think, more and more in general. Because if you want to reuse then your program, you have to abstract the program that you are doing, thinking to other use that you can do for it. Usually it is an exercise that you have to stop somewhere, because you cannot do the most general program of the world, whose answer is 42 as in science fiction, which is the last answer of the world. And the answer at the end of this story of sci-fi story is 42. But then you have this problem. So x minus 2 equals to 0. X means that A is 1 and B is minus 2. With respect to the classes that we did yesterday, you see we have a class that we call linear regression. And then we have two fields that I declare static, A minus 1 and B minus 2. The name of the class was wrong there. The usual convention is having the name of the class with the capital letters, and every word starting with capital letters. So here I modify statics. We already talked yesterday what static is. Means that these two variables are actually part of the class, not of an instantiation of the things, not of the object. In fact, when I actually, this is just actually, is not even programming this one, like I wrote this. I am not obviously satisfied in doing this. Because then we have a main and see if we take the number and we print the result on the screen. And what is not satisfying, but it's not satisfying to many respects. First, we have fixed the values of A and B, and we want to be the values of A and B parameterized. Secondly, we didn't treat any special case of B. In fact, for instance, if A is equal, would be equal to zero. And actually also, we are not doing a program that is actually reusable. This program here just stands in itself is a sort of scripting more than a program. Because I have to this specific task, I solve this specific task, and of the whole thing. This is not actually the program. We say the static belongs to the class. Then when we do exercises about this later on, we will do some variations on this scheme to see the difference between statics and other things. And static variables are initialized one time. Actually, we could have declared the variable final. In that case, the variable cannot also be modified. Here they can be modified, but there is one single place in the memory of the computer that contains those variables. If you change the values, they are changed for everyone. The program that you see before is not so complicated, so we cannot instantiate actually a class, create object of that class. It's not that program is so simple that we cannot. There is nothing inside, and there is not the creation of objects. If not the main object, the main class. And so we cannot do this, but we will then create a little more complicated program where we can create object from a class similar to this one. And then we will experiment what means static or not static. In practice. One thing that we didn't see before is that we declare the number double. Double precision number is a type 64-bit number, is a specific static double. There are other types in Java. One is byte. A byte is a character that is 8-bit. The other is short, 16-bit. An int is 32-bit. It goes from number. You see from where to where all those numbers goes. And then longer in integer and float. There are primitive types in Java. They are sort of inherit from C, and they are primitive types, so in Java not everything is a class. A pure object-oriented language has only classes. Here there are some specific objects that for efficiency were coded outside this scheme, and these are the number that you see. Also there are characters and Boolean. Characters contain strings of word, and Boolean just say yes or no to one. Or so you have these types, primitive types. They are not object, but for any one of them with a capital letter there is a object that wrap that's primitive. This actually has causes some problems because in some mathematical operations you have to unwrap the double here, the double class, the float class, and then you do actually the operation on the primitive types. And This operation of unwrapping, which is called unboxing, that takes time, and you can do 1,000 millions of times this operation, can cost a lot, every cost. Other thing to be noticed, the variable are declared, and the type of the variable are declared. Are declared, and the variable are initialized to a value. So, indeed, this program is really simple, but there are a lot of things inside that we usually give for granted and we don't give a look. So, A equal to 1 means that we assign a value. But then we also have defined which type of we have here. And in fact, Java is a strong type of language. Not like Python, for instance, where we don't have to declare all this stuff. The language, they take care itself of this stuff. To be more comprehensive regarding for generalizing the problem, I refocus a little bit. Our scope is not just to solve a problem. I have a need and I have to solve it right away. When we program, we need to have this attitude to say, okay, I solved this problem, but I solved this time. I don't say forever because that is impossible, but and the solution that I find has to remain for quite a time, and I have to reuse this software, not redo over and over again. So that's what was not the way to go. And here we have to consider, we want to consider any couple of A and B, and avoid a case, for instance, in which A is equal to 0 or B is equal to 0. If both are equal to 0, we have an identity 0 equal to 0, so we should return the fact that this is an identity. This analysis shows or clarify better what is the concept of robustness. We have a problem, we analyze all the cases, and there is no case that can remain out. Here is simple because the problem is simple. In a much more complex problem is not so easy. So we have to test it, to do testing, to do workarounds, to have heuristics to decide if we are doing exactly what we are considering all the cases that happen. So we have various actions here, reading A and B from somewhere, and this is an action. Solve the equation is another action, and then we have also the printing of the results that are another action. One good way from the point of view of giving a solution to this is to split this in three classes. Each one paradigm could be one class, one responsibility. Meaning one class do just one thing. And you know, we are getting A and B, so we are building maybe a routine that writes every A and B for any problem that we can analyze in the following. Or maybe if the thing is particularly simple, we don't go to this much to this complexity, but we can think about to create our reading library for doing or our reading class for a text. Then we have the calculation. The calculation can be another class, it assumes to have the value, so we can test that before. We solve separately also the problem. We encapsulate one problem in one class, and this helps us to do the things and the testing and to build the robustness and to go on. And then we see how to do it. So, next time.